Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, me and Adamya are presenting the case. I'll start
Yeah,
sharing my
okay.
screen.
Yeah. There are 68 people. I think a few more people are yet to join. Just wait for 2 more minutes.
All right, ma'am.
Yeah. Just a set of instructions. Term and eighth term batch are combined. So sixth term will be dealing with the history taking basics of examination. Eighth term will be the details. At the end of the class, you will be given certain assignments which have to be written and submitted to the department email ID by the next day morning. Okay. These assignments will be considered for your internal assessment exam. So they have to be submitted on a daily basis. Okay, Abhishek, you may start your presentation.
This is too much of fan noise. Just a moment, ma'am.
Be loud and clear.
Yes, ma'am. Audible? I'm audible. Okay.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. I'm Abhishek, and I'll be presenting a CNS case today. So, Mr. ABC, a 55-year-old male who is hailing from Padel, Mangalore, who is a shop owner by occupation. History was given by himself and his wife, which is reliable. He's right-handed and was admitted on 24th of March and examined on 25th of March. He presented with the chief complaints of weakness of right upper and lower limb since one day and deviation of angle of mouth to the left since one day. History of presenting illness showed patient was apparently normal today morning, but then he experienced sudden onset, rapidly progressive weakness on the right side while having breakfast. Now, weakness included right upper limb, as the patient was unable to hold the spoon and button his shirt thereafter. He also included right lower limb, as he was unable to get up from sitting position and was unable to rise to the hospital. The weakness was equal in both limbs and included both proximal as well as distal part. There is associated drooling of saliva on the right side and deviation of the angle of mouth to the left side while speaking, eating and showing teeth. Negative history include no history of loss of sensations, burning
Okay,
sensation
let
or
me
pain.
interrupt you there. Okay, so far I've had a patient who has had weakness of the right of one day along with the deviation of angle of mouth of one day duration. So at this point, what would you like to consider? At the level
We're
of
not able to
history,
hear you actually.
at the level of history, you have a patient who is having weakness of the right upper and lower limb of one day duration along with angle of deviation of the mouth of one day duration. In your history of presenting illness, you said he was absolutely normal until that morning. He's woken up and he's having breakfast and suddenly developed weakness. So at this point, what is your inference?
Ma'am, it can be a thrombotic stroke or any kind of stroke. We don't know the etiology, but it can be a stroke which has resulted in this hemiplegia, which is along with the it is a UMN lesion because of there is associated facial or palsy on the same side. So it's probably a stroke. Apart from a stroke, it can be any other thing like a sudden trauma, which would have less. We have to elicit the trauma history, but there's no history of trauma. So
in this,
it
you
can
don't
be
have
an
a history of trauma. So unless you've elicited the history, trauma is out. So what I'm trying to point out is if you have a sudden onset history, which is instantaneous within seconds to minutes, it always points out towards a vascular event unless proven otherwise. Okay. So in a neurology case, when you have, you divide the pathologies into vascular, inflammatory, infectious, neoplastic, degenerative. Vascular is always very sudden onset. Okay. Other infectious inflammatory causes are more of subacute onset. So the duration of symptoms is a few days to a few weeks. Okay. And even neoplastic is a more of a subacute to a chronic onset. The duration of symptoms, even if it's a space occupying lesion, which can present with the weakness of the left upper and lower limb, the duration of the and the progression will be a slow progression, and the time of onset will be much more preceding than the sudden onset of the event. And even in degenerative illnesses, it progresses over a few months to a few years. Okay. So you said you are considering thrombotic event here. So thrombotic event, if you're suspecting a vascular event and it is a stroke, what are the various pathologies that can lead to a stroke? You said one was thrombotic. What were the other pathologies?
Ma'am, it can be an embolic stroke, or it can be a hemorrhagic stroke, or it is a lacunar defect.
Okay. So how will you differentiate between these three?
Ma'am, based on the history findings, we can say that if there is associated cardiovascular abnormalities like previous history of palpitation, breathlessness, or sudden onset chest pain, it is most likely that the stroke is having an embolic origin from cardiovascular system. If there is associated hypertension, or if he has an associated risk factor of smoking and the other thing which says that there is an associated atherosclerosis, it can be a thrombotic stroke. And on the history examination only, it's like hypertensive or if patient is very hypertensive, and a sudden hypertension can also cause hemorrhagic stroke.
Okay. So the first thing what you have to consider is the age of the patient. Okay. It is generally of these pathologies common, thrombotic and which is more common. Thrombotic and embolic come under the category of ischemic strokes, okay? And hemorrhagic stroke is a separate category. Which is more common or ischemia or hemorrhage?
Ma'am, we are not. Your voice is not clear, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Between these three, one is thrombotic and embolic comes under the category of ischemic strokes, okay? And hemorrhagic is a separate end. Out of these three,
yes,
which is more common?
Ischemic are most common, ma'am.
Yeah, ischemic is more common, and out of which thrombotic is more commoner than
most.
Thrombotic, okay? And what first thing you have to consider is the age of the patient. So which age group do you see embolic? Which age group do you see hemorrhagic or thrombotic?
Ma'am, in less than 60 years of patient, it's actually thrombotic stroke. And if the patient is more than 60 years, it's usually hemorrhagic.
Okay, in the ischemic category, that is a thrombotic and embolic is generally seen in a younger age group. Okay, so if you have a person with a younger age group, when we say that this is when you consider a stroke in young or less than 45 years of age, the person presents to you with stroke, you have to remember it comes under the category of stroke in young. Okay, and generally it is a younger age group, and they may be having a preceding cardiac ailment, like you said, which could be a valvular heart disease, like a rheumatic heart disease, any other mitral stenosis or any other valvular heart disease. So the source of origin is always the cardiac or the atheroembolic, so or from the large vessels like the carotids. So embolic, you have to remember, is younger age group. they have a precipitating event such as stress or exercise or any other event. So when they are doing any stressful activity, that is when they develop the stroke. Okay, and the deficit that happens during an embolic stroke is maximum at the onset. So whatever deficit they are having will be a maximum at the onset, and with the treatment of the embolus, the deficit may slowly recover. Okay, whereas in the other groups, that is thrombotic, in the history, what you can have is in the preceding one day of the illness that they develop the stroke, one day before the illness, they may be having a slow throbbing headache because of the development of slow occlusion there is in the vessels. They develop collaterals because of which they have a vascular headache. And what time of the day does a thrombotic stroke happen generally?
Morning, ma'am, when his patient is getting up from the sleep.
Yes, early morning stroke. Okay, so thrombotic happens early morning. So night time they go to sleep very comfortably. Early morning it wakes them up from the sleep, so it's called as a wake up stroke. Okay, early morning 4 a.m. that's when you see, and there are various factors that contribute to it. So early morning when they wake up, they develop this deficit, it wakes them up from the sleep, and they notice the deficit and the progression of the, because the thrombus is a gradually developing phenomenon. So over the time period of 48 to 72 or 72 hours, they develop progressive deficit, that is the stroke in evolution or stuttering progression. And then after 72 hours, it stops progressing. Okay, so this is about a thrombotic illness. In a hemorrhagic illness, again, the age group is generally seen in the older age group. Along with that, what are the symptoms they will have if they had hemorrhagic stroke? Along with the deficit, what other symptoms will they have? Heard of thunderclap, headache. Okay, they can have a severe headache along with the preceding the development of stroke, and their deficit also progresses because once there is bleeding into the cerebral circulation, they can have irritation of the surrounding cortical area, they can have seizures, and because there is hemorrhage, they can develop surrounding edema, because of which they can also have the progression of deficits. Okay, yeah, you can proceed.
There is no history of loss of sensation or burning sensation or pain. No history of change in smell sensation, double vision, appearance of black spots, loss of vision, reduction in visual field, loss of sensation.
I think your PPT is, you have to change the slides.
Oh, just a moment. Is it visible now, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
There is no history of loss of sensation, burning sensation or pain. No history of change in smell sensation, double vision, appearance of black spots, loss of vision, or a reduction in visual field, or loss of sensation on face. There is no history of giddiness, vertigo, tinnitus, reduced hearing. There is no history of difficulty in swallowing, nasal irritation, drooping of the shoulder. No history of loss of consciousness or loss of balance, tremors, or swaying while walking. No history of altered sensorium or behavioral abnormalities. No history of involuntary movements or seizures. No history of headache, no vomiting. And there is no history of breathlessness or palpitations or swelling of the legs.
Okay, what about the bowel and bladder habits?
Yeah, ma'am, no history of urinary and fecal incontinence also.
What about the gait?
That has been written in the examination.
No, you have to elicit in history also. What about the speech?
There was no slurred speech or dysarthria, ma'am.
No, you said he had a deviation of the angle of the mouth. He had difficulty in eating.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So what kind of speech deficit, what component of the speech do you think will be affected here?
Ma'am, articulation problem.
Yeah, he'll have a difficulty in articulation. Okay, all these things you have to elicit in the history itself. Okay, most of the things you will be able to cover in history itself. You said no history of altered sensorium or behavioral abnormalities and seizures. Why did you ask for the history?
Ma'am, cortical involvement, cortex is involved or not?
Very good. Whenever you have a cortical stroke, you will have, if it's a large enough stroke, you will have altered sensorium, your consciousness level will be quite impaired, and cortical involvement generally can present with having seizures. Okay. Yeah, you can proceed.
So past history, there is no history of similar complaints in the past, but there is a history of mild intermittent chest pain in the past for which he consulted local hospital and was prescribed treatment. The pain subsided on medication but appeared again, for which nothing was done. He is a known hypertensive since 15 years and is on medication with poor adherence, and a known diabetic since 10 years for which he is on medication with adequate compliance. There is no history of no past history of TIA, transient ischemic attacks. They're not
How
in
did
one
you
case
ask
of
for that history?
Ma'am, if there is any similar complaints which resolved automatically within 24 hours of time, like he had similar complaints in the past, which like he felt the weakness, but he recovered from that weakness within 24 hours of time, ma'am.
He did not have any of that.
No, ma'am.
Okay. What is your inference of the chest pain that he is having?
Ma'am, probably he has a cardiovascular disease because he might have atherosclerosis in the heart, or which may help us to diagnose the stroke further, that is a thrombotic kind of stroke or something.
You said mild intermittent chest pain. Now, if you want to localize it to the cardiovascular system and you want to ascertain what kind of a chest pain is it, what history would you have asked further?
Sorry, ma'am, I didn't get you.
In view of the mild intermittent chest pain that he has, yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
If you want to ascertain what exactly is it in and you want to localize it to the cardiovascular system per se, what history would you have asked in this patient further?
Ma'am, about the...
What do you think it is in the first place?
Ma'am, whether it relieved on taking nitroglycerin, what is the character of the pain?
Yes.
Whether there was... Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah.
Like, if it's a cardiovascular pain, which is like constricting or heavy pain kind of pain.
So you have to ask whether it is fits into angina or not. What is angina?
Sorry?
What is angina? What is angina pectoris? Define angina pectoris.
Ma'am, angina pectoris is actually chest pain due to which is there due to intermittent myocardial ischemia, which typically presents as a dull discomfort.
Location, characteristics of the pain, radiation, leaf. Exacerbating factors.
Ma'am, it is retrosternal in origin, and it is a progressive pain which increases in 1 or 2 days, or
no.
1 or 2 minutes.
Not 1 or 2 days. It lasts for a few minutes. Okay, 10 to 15 minutes. Retrosternal crushing or heavy discomfort like feeling, which is present in the retrosternal area. Radiation to the jaws, arms, medial aspect of the arms. Or towards the lower part of the abdomen, exacerbating with exercise or any heavy exertional activity, and with relief, obtains relief with nitrates. Okay. So when you're saying angina, there are two types of angina, unstable and stable angina. Unstable angina occurs even without any precipitating factors. So if a person per se is just seated and he develops this kind of an intermittent chest pain, which fits into the characteristics of angina, but he doesn't have any exertional activity associated with it, then it becomes an unstable angina. That means it occurs at any point, or else stable angina when he only exerts himself and he develops these characteristics, then it becomes a stable angina. Okay. Proceed. Why did you ask for history of go back, please? Why did you ask for history of bronchial asthma, COPD? Here, bronchial asthma, COPD, tuberculosis. You've also written bleeding and clotting disorders, epileptic disorders.
Yes, ma'am. Bronchial, ma'am, because if he had any bleeding and clotting disorders, he would have taken anticoagulants. So, ma'am, these are actually a risk factor for hemorrhagic stroke.
Bleeding disorders, you wouldn't give anticoagulants, no?
Clotting disorder, ma'am.
Hypercoagulable states. What is his age? What is the age of this
years.
Patient? 65.
55 years, ma'am.
55 years. So why would you suspect bleeding or clotting disorders at this point of time? Okay, whenever you're having stroke in young and you don't have any risk factors for a stroke per se, then you have to think of other causes. Okay, then
okay.
These kind of questions come into play, whether it is tuberculosis, bleeding and clotting disorders, all this come into play when you're suspecting a stroke in young. In this patient, he's a 55-year-old man. He's diabetic. He's known hypertensive for 15 odd years. You already have enough risk factors for you to explain why a stroke is happening, okay? Why bronchial asthma and COPD?
I have no idea.
Okay, not relevant to your history, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can.
There is no history of prior surgeries or any known allergies. On drug history, he's on medications for hypertension and diabetes mellitus, which are not known. There is no history of use of anticoagulants or any alternate medicine or medicine without prescription. Family history, his brother was a hypertensive and he died of myocardial infarction 5 years ago at the age of 63 years. Personal history, mixed diet, normal appetite, his sleep is adequate, he has regular bowel and bladder movements. He has a history of positive history of smoking since 30 years, one pack per day, 30 pack years. There is no history of alcohol or any other substance abuse. Summary for the case is that a 55-year-old male who presented with the complaints of sudden onset right-sided weakness of both upper and lower limb since one day and the deviation of angle of mouth towards left since one day. He is a known case of hypertension, diabetes and non-compliant to medications. He also experienced mild intermittent chest pain in the past. I also have a positive family history of myocardial infarction and he's a chronic smoker.
What is your diagnosis? Summarize your history. See, whenever you're finishing a CNS historical diagnosis, you have to categorize it into what is the pathology here? What is the deficit that the patient has? That is the functional deficit, whatever it is, hemiparesis, hemiplegia. Which vascular territory is involved according to you in history? And what are the risk factors that he's had? Etiologies.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
So
all your points are there in the summary. You just have to put it into place.
Yes, ma'am.
So what is the pathology here?
Ma'am, there is a pathology is actually that there is hypertension and So
relax. It's okay. Slowly. Tell me what is the functional deficit first.
Ma'am, functional deficit is that he has right-sided complete hemiplegia of both upper and lower limb along with the upper motor neuron 7th cranial nerve involvement.
He had complete upper and lower limb weakness, hemiplegia or just weakness. Was he able to support after he developed the weakness in the morning? Was he able to walk by himself? Did he needed one person support? Did he needed two people support? No. What information does that give you?
Ma'am, whether he is there's some function remaining or not in that limb.
See, when a patient is able to walk without support, for sure you know that the grade of power is almost 3. That means he is able to move his muscles against gravity. Okay, so if he is able to walk without support, that means it is at least grade 3 power is there. It doesn't become a plegia. Plegia means complete loss of power. So at least zero, that will be zero power. Okay, so
okay.
Whether it was hemiparesis, you think there was mild weakness or there was complete weakness?
It's hemiparesis, ma'am.
Okay, so it is right-sided hemiparesis. And you said it is equal affection of the upper and the lower limb. Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and along with that, he has deviation of the angle of the mouth. So what is that going to tell you?
Ma'am, because that anatomically there is a right left internal capsular lesion, which is...
Before that, the complete functional deficit is right-sided hemiparesis with probable Uhlmann type of facial palsy. Yes? Okay.
Yes,
then, anatomical localization?
Posterior limb as well as the genu of the internal capsule is involved, which is... which involves
first
the cortical spinal.
How will you say it is cortex, subcortex, whether it is the brain stem or anywhere else, spinal cord, or whether it's the nerves that are involved? You already said in history there was no loss of consciousness, there was no altered behavior, so cortex is ruled out, so it is somewhere in the subcortical area. You said internal capsule. If it is the internal capsule, what will be the kind of deficit generally if it's the genu that is involved? See, what happens is once your cortical area is coming down from your fibers, upper motor nerve, if you remember the corticospinal tract, as it descends down into corona radiata, then comes down, and the fibers are very densely packed in the posterior limb of the internal capsule. So if the posterior limb of the internal capsule is involved, it is generally going to be a dense hemiplegia, that is complete loss of power generally and equal affection of the upper and the lower limb. Whereas if it is a cortex that is involved, then it will have unequal involvement of the upper and lower limb. Because if you remember the motor homunculus, most medially you will have the limb, whereas as you go laterally on the cortex, naturally you will get the upper areas, your face, lips, your tongue and pharyngeal muscle come most laterally. So if it is to be involved the entire cortex, then only you will have an equal affection of the upper and the lower limb. Whereas if it's the internal capsule, you should have a complete loss of power and facial nerve involvement, dense hemiplegia. Okay, remember that. So it's probably somewhere in the subcortex, maybe involving the corona radiata. Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Risk factors?
Ma'am, he has hypertension. He's diabetic. He also has smoker. And main is the age of the patient.
Male gender itself is a risk factor, okay? Another thing... what is the pathology here? You said the etiologies. Pathology?
Yes, ma'am. Atherosclerosis.
No. Thrombotic embolic hemorrhagic. What do you think it is here?
Ma'am, thrombotic.
Thrombotic, why?
Because, ma'am, there is associated atherosclerosis because of hypertension and chest
pain.
How will
you justify it in history? I told you what are the points in favor of a thrombotic stroke. So how will it progress? How will they present to you? So what are the points in favor in your history that could be telling it is a thrombotic stroke?
Wake up stroke, ma'am.
Okay. Progression. Did it progress over the next few days? You said weakness was for one day. What happened over the next few days?
Ma'am, that was continued. Ma'am, didn't...
Okay, so you think it is thrombotic, okay? This is how you're supposed to summarize the diagnosis of CNS, okay? I hope you understood.
Yes, ma'am.
Are there any doubts? Y'all can enter your doubts in the chat box if y'all have any doubts at this point. I know it's a little difficult to coordinate in online classes, but if y'all have any doubts, you can enter it in the chat box, okay? You may proceed. Continue the presentation.
General physical examination, an elderly male was lying down comfortably on his bed. Limb attitude appeared normal. Patient was conscious, cooperative and body oriented to the time and place and person. He was moderately built and nourished. Weight is 65 kg, height is 160 cm. BMI comes out to be 25.39 kilogram per meter square.
Generally don't mention the attitude in your general physical examination, okay? Because it all depends on which position you're going to examine the patient in. Don't mention the attitude, just the higher mental function, that is the consciousness level, and your basic characteristics of the vitals. Okay.
All right.
Yes.
Pulse is 170 beats per minute, irregular, normal volume, normal character. Arterial wall is thickened. And
not thickened.
RSFL is not taken. Peripheral pulses are felt with normal intensity bilaterally. There is no radio-radial or radiofemoral delay. Blood pressure is 190.
So, what is the inference? In history, you did not get any cardiac complaints otherwise before the stroke.
Yes, ma'am.
In the history, you did not get any cardiac complaints at all.
Ma'am, we got no mild intermittent chest pain.
That is past history. During the current episode, when he had the stroke, did you have any complaints? Did he have any complaints?
No, ma'am.
Preceding the onset of his weakness?
No, ma'am.
No, nothing. Okay. So what is your inference of the pulse characteristics?
Ma'am, irregular pulse is seen in atrial fibrillations.
Okay. Any other cause of irregular pulse?
Multiple ectopics, ma'am.
Okay.
I'm aware of two causes.
Okay, fine. So if it is, how will you differentiate between these two, atrial fibrillation and ectopics? Both are going to be irregular, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So how will you differentiate between atrial fibrillation and ectopics?
ECG, ma'am.
You only have history at this point. And examination, no ECG.
Don't know.
Okay. One is the rate, okay? Atrial fibrillation, then the rate is generally higher, okay? Above 150. Also, irregular pulse when you have, you are supposed to check something called as apex pulse deficit. What is apex pulse deficit? You've heard of apex pulse deficit?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you know what it is?
Ma'am, there is one person has to check the pulse, another person has to take the stethoscope and hear the heart rate. So, if there's a difference between both of them, it is known as apex pulse deficit.
Within how heart much rate is the difference?
From the,
okay, so what happens is apex pulse deficit. Whenever you have an irregular pulse, you are supposed to check for something called as apex pulse deficit. So you can check it during the same cardiac cycle or two different cardiac cycles. If you have only one examiner, you don't have any, you can check the heart rate for 1 whole minute. And the next cardiac cycle, you can palpate for the pulse and count the peripheral pulses. So if this difference of the heart rate and the peripheral pulse is more than 10, then you say the apex pulse deficit is positive, okay, which you see in atrial fibrillation. And in ectopics, you will not see that. The apex pulse deficit will be less than 10. Okay. Another thing is, if you ask them to exercise, suppose you ask them to walk about for a period of half an hour after, once you get this pulsation, and you ask them to walk for half an hour, in ectopics, the irregularity will disappear. Whereas in atrial fibrillation, it will not disappear and it will remain the same. Okay. Understood? Suppose this patient had bradycardia, what is your inference? If this patient would have had bradycardia? In a CNS case, what is the significance of having bradycardia? Heard of Cushing's reflex?
No, ma'am.
Okay. In a patient who has raised intracranial pressures, because of the involvement of the brainstem, they can develop hypertension, elevated BP readings, along with bradycardia and irregular breathing pattern, bradypnea. The irregular respiration, this suggests a possible raised intracranial pressures. So when there is a very large mass, or where there is a large arterial stroke that is involved, entire cortex is involved, then they can have a raised intracranial pressure because of the edema, surrounding edema. Okay. So if at all you have a bradycardia in a patient who is having CNS, CNS. That could be one of the reasons. Okay. Yes.
Sure.
Any other thing that you can think of if they would have had bradycardia?
Any associated
is a hypertensive, so drugs, okay, any drugs?
Yes, ma'am.
That they are on beta blockers.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, proceed.
Blood pressure is 190/100 mmHg, measured on right brachial artery in supine position. Respiratory rate is 18 cycles per minute, predominantly abdominal thoracic pattern. Depth is normal and there is no use of accessory muscle for respiration. Temperature, axillary temperature of 37.3 degrees Celsius.
How did you check the blood pressure in this patient?
I'm
How would you have checked the blood pressure in this patient?
Sphygmomanometer.
I'm telling you, based on your pulse examination, how should you have checked the blood pressure? According to your assessment of the pulse, you think this patient could be having atrial fibrillation, you said?
Yes?
Yeah. So how are you supposed to check the blood pressure in a patient is having atrial fibrillation? How many readings are you supposed to check?
3, ma'am.
Yeah, you're supposed to check an average of 3 readings, okay? So you have 3 separate limb BP readings and take an average of that, not a single blood pressure reading. Remember that, okay? Yes, proceed.
There is no evidence of pallor, icterus, sinuses, clubbing, generalized lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. There is no resting squint, nystagmus or ptosis, no engorged neck veins, and no evidence of xanthomas. Ma'am, the remaining of the examination, CNS examination will be presented.
You needn't mention this squint, nystagmus, ptosis. It will be mentioned in the cranial nerve examination, okay? So you needn't mention it here.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. I'll be continuing with the local examination of CNS.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. First, we go
you
to
PowerPoint, Adamya.
I couldn't prepare it in my phone, ma'am. So I'll be doing it orally.
Okay, proceed.
Okay. So first, we go to the higher mental functions. Patient is conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place, and person. Appearance and behavior appropriate. Emotionally stable, general intelligence is average, recent, intermediate and remote memory is intact. He's a right-handed individual. Speech output, it's slurred speech with good fluency, comprehension and repetition.
Okay, so what are the other components of speech?
The comprehension and repetition.
You said fluency, you said comprehension. You said repetition.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Can't hear you, ma'am. Like, it's not clear.
Fluency, comprehension, and repetition are the only three things you mentioned.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What are the other things that you have missed in speech?
No, ma'am.
Naming, reading, and writing. When you're writing speech in the high mental, you're supposed to mention naming, reading, and writing.
Yes, ma'am.
Suppose the comprehension is impaired. What do you do with this?
Ma'am, like, your voice is not hearing, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What are the types of speech disorders that you know of?
Motor aphasia.
Aphasias, dysarthrias, dysphasias, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So, mainly what you have to know is at least the aphasia. So, what is Broca's aphasia? What is Wernicke's aphasia? What is global aphasia?
Broca's aphasia, word output is decreased, ma'am. It's not fluent.
Okay. But comprehension will be intact. In other words, in Broca's aphasia, they will be able to understand what you're saying. They will be able to follow your commands, but they will not be able to speak fluently or repeat what you're trying to say fluently enough.
Okay? Yes.
Whereas in Wernicke's aphasia, it is the comprehension that is intact. So what happens is they are not able to understand what you're trying to say, and they will give you irrelevant answers. If you ask them something, they will give you completely irrelevant answers because they are not understanding what you are trying to say. So in other words, it's called something called as a jargon speech. So they just keep on speaking without making any sense of it. Okay, that is one. Whereas in global aphasia, you have impairment of both. Not understanding, comprehension, as well as speech output and so global aphasia. There are other ones which are not going into the transcortic sensory. That's not important. It is this much.
Like continuing with the cranial nerve examination.
Also, generally, if you think the cortex is involved, you might have to assess for language, arithmetic skills, and all of that. Also, if any abnormal behavior like delusions and hallucinations.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Proceed.
Okay. Cranial nerve examination. Olfactory nerve smell test is normal on both sides. Optic nerve visual acuity normal by counting finger at 6 meter test, normal on both sides. Color vision is normal on both sides. Then cranial nerves 3, 4, 6, that is oculomotor, trochlear, and abducens.
What else are you missing in the second cranial nerve examination?
Pupillary shape. Pupil is round.
Yes. And
it's reactive to light.
Okay. Endoscopy.
Endoscopy is not done.
Yeah, you're supposed to mention it. Okay, especially in a patient of CNS who is having hypertension, diabetes, we have some retinopathy changes as well as tension. You may have papillary. So fundoscopy is important.
Okay.
Yes.
Third, fourth, sixth cranial nerves. Normal ocular motility in all directions, both sides.
Yes.
Normal pupillary reflex, direct and indirect, normal on both sides. There is ptosis on the right side, normal on left, and no nystagmus. Coming to cranial nerve 5, trigeminal. Sensory, it's intact on both sides. Motor intact on both sides. Jaw jerk is absent.
There is no nystagmus.
Facial nerve, motor function. The angle of the mouth is deviated to the right. Left side normal. Nasolabial fold absent on the right. Left side normal. Absent forehead wrinkling on the right side. Left side it's normal. Taste sensation in anterior one third of the tongue is normal on both sides.
Okay.
Vestibular cochlear nerve, normal hearing by ticking watch
what
test.
What about eye closure?
Yes, ma'am.
Absent on the.
Didn't hear you, ma'am. What?
Forehead wrinkling is absent on the right side.
Yes, ma'am. Right side is absent.
What about eye closure?
He's able to close.
Very unlikely, no? At this point, what is your inference?
There is a facial nerve involvement, palsy.
LMN, UMN?
UMN, ma'am. It's a indicative of UMN lesion.
You said forehead wrinkling is absent.
Yes, ma'am.
So that is seen in UMN or LMN? What are the differentiating features between UMN and LMN facial nerve palsy? Or but
UMN,
as much of frontalis is involved in which one? The drinking will be lost in LMN type of facial palsy. Along with that, difficulty in eye closure, something called as Bell's phenomenon.
Yes.
Okay? When they try to close their eyes, the eyeball will go upward and outward. Then, nerve to stapedius may be involved in that. So they may have a hyperacusis.
Yes.
These are the differentiating features. This is some of the differentiating features which you have to, when you're saying that drinking is absent, you have to be a little careful. Okay? So okay. What does that point out? If it is, you're thinking of the element kind of a facial nerve involvement here, does that change your diagnosis in any way?
No, ma'am.
He said, the first person said that the, he was trying to localize it to the internal capsule. Okay. Where do you get element kind of facial nerve involvement? What is element? What is lower motor neuron? See, seventh cranial nerve nuclei is located in which part of the brain stem? Pons, okay? So anything below the cranial nerve nuclei up to the supply of the muscles is lower motor neuron. That is the path of the nerve. Understood? That is what is lower motor neuron. Upper motor neuron is the entire corticospinal tract. So your motor manipulus, coronal radiata, internal capsule, middle cerebral peduncle, and up to the anterior horn cell. That is your upper motor neuron. From the anterior horn cell up to the supply of the muscle, that is your lower motor neuron. Okay. Okay. I think this will be a little confusing for you. Remember, lower motor neuron is when the facial nerve is involved below the brain stem. Okay. That is when you get the lower motor type of facial palsy. Okay.
Yes, yeah. So coming to the vestibular cochlear now, normal hearing by ticking was tested on both sides. Then glossopharyngeal and vagus, taste to the posterior 1/3 is normal on both sides. Then no nasal intonation to the speech on both sides. Spinal axillary nerve, shrugging of shoulders is normal strength on both sides. Turning head against resistance, normal on both sides. Interpretation, there's normal sternocleidomastoid and trapezius.
Okay.
Hypoglossal nerve, no deviation on protrusion of the tongue and no atrophy of the tongue on both sides.
Okay.
Coming to the motor sister examination, muscle bulk, that is the assessment of the nutrition to assess atrophy. Arm circumference, right side 18 centimeter, left side 17 centimeter. Forearm circumference, right side 13 centimeter, left side 13. Thigh circumference, 31 centimeters, left side 30 centimeters. Calf, right side 23 centimeters and left side 23. Interpretation, there's no atrophy noted bilaterally. Coming to the tone of the muscles, upper limb, flexor and extensor, right side it's spastic, left side normal. Lower limb, flexor and extensor, right side it's spastic, left side normal. Impression is a clasp knife spasticity on right side in both upper limb and lower limb.
Okay. What is tone? Define tone.
It's the ability, it's the natural resistance of the muscle.
To
an external force. Tension in the muscle at rest.
Resistance offered by a muscle to passive stretch. That is what is tone, okay? What are the types of tone that you know?
There's a clasp knife spasticity.
No, how did... What are the two types of tone that you're assessing? You said here there is spastic. Okay.
Yes.
So, increased tone and decreased tone. So hypertonia,
spastic.
Hypertonia, hypotonia. In hypertonia, what are the causes? What are the types of hypertonia that you know of?
Just one second.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
What are the types of hypertonia?
Spastic and dystonic.
Spasticity and rigidity. Okay, these are the two types of tone, hypertonia. So how do you differentiate between these two and where do you see these? You said clasp knife spasticity, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So what happens in clasp knife spasticity?
Ma'am, there is a rapid decrease in resistance when attempting to flex the joint.
Okay. So what happens in clasp knife is only at the initial movement you have increased resistance, then there will be a sudden giving way. Okay, that is clasp knife spasticity, like a clasp knife. Suddenly, initially there will be resistance, then whereas rigidity is something where there is increased resistance throughout the range of movement. That's why to try to bend a lead pipe, that's why it's called as the lead pipe rigidity. So if you try to bend a lead pipe, there will be resistance throughout the range of movement. It's not going to give way anywhere in between. Which are the conditions you will see either of these two?
Spasticity occurs in pyramidal tract lesions.
Okay, very good.
Internal capsule. Then
not only internal capsule, any UMN lesions can give rise to spasticity. Not necessarily can give rise to spasticity in the recovery phase. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Any spinal cord lesions like compressive myelopathy, okay, they can have spasticity. Then motor neuron diseases. Okay, they can have both UMN and LMN signs, so they can have spasticity. Then where do you see lead pipe rigidity?
In basal ganglion lesions.
So anything that involves the extrapyramidal tract that can have lead pipe rigidity, right? Parkinson's disease is one of the examples. Okay. Yes.
Shall I continue?
Yeah.
Coming to the power, upper limb, shoulder joint, flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, rotation. Grade 2 on right side and normal on left. Elbow, flexion extension, grade 2 on right and grade 5 on left. Wrist, all the movements are grade 2 and grade 5 on the left side. Fingers, all the movements in the right side are grade 2 and left side are grade 5. Lower limbs, hip joint, all the movements are grade 2 on the right side and grade 5 on the left side. Knee joint, all the movements grade 2 on right and left, left side normal. Ankle joint grade 2 on right, left side normal. Toes, flexion extension, grade 2 on right side and grade 5 on left. Coming to the coordination, upper limb, lost coordination on the right side. Lower limb, lost coordination on the right side and left side is normal. Gait, adapted shoulder, flexed elbow, flexed and semi-pronated wrist. Then extension of the interphalangeal on the affected side. And that's the right side. There's no involuntary movement seen bilaterally.
Yeah, proceed.
Reflexes, superficial reflexes, corneal reflexes present on both sides, conjunctival reflex present on both sides. Hoffman sign is positive on right and negative on the left side. Abdominal reflex lost on the right side and present on the left side. Plantar reflex, extensor on the right and flexor on the left side.
Okay. What are the components of a plantar reflex?
Yes, ma'am, I didn't get it.
What are the components of a plantar reflex?
Uh, It's called as a Babinski sign, ma'am.
When do you say a Babinski is positive?
There's dysfunction of corticospinal tract.
When do you say you are going to interpret it as positive Babinski's or negative Babinski's, right? When will you say it is a positive Babinski sign? What is the complete positive Babinski sign?
Yes, ma'am. There's dorsiflexion of the great toe. Then fanning out of and extension of the other toes. And dorsiflexion of the ankle.
Yes.
And contraction of the tensor fascia.
Dorsiflexion of the ankle then?
Flexion of the hip and knee. There is involvement of flexion.
Hip and knee and contraction of the
tensor fascia.
What are the reflexes and the biceps jerk? You finished your deep tendon reflexes? No. Superficial.
Yes,
proceed.
Deep tendon reflexes, bicep reflex, it's +3 on right and +2 on left. Supinator reflex, +3 on right, +2 on left. Tricep jerk, +3 on right and +2 on left. Knee reflex, +4 on right and +3 on left. Ankle reflex, +2 on right and +1 on left.
Okay.
So the impression is absent superficial reflexes and
exaggerated. Would you like to check for some? Yes, said there is classfulness spasticity in the reflexes. Would you like to check something?
No idea.
Clonus, okay. Did you check for clonus?
Yes.
Clonus is nothing but an exaggerated deep tendon reflexes. Beyond grade 3, the grade 4 of the exaggerated reflex response is clonus, okay?
Yes, ma'am. So the impression is absent superficial reflexes and exaggerated deep reflexes on the right side.
Okay.
It's an indicative of UMN lesion.
Okay.
Then sensory system examination.
Can you tell me the reflexes and their root values? Bicep jerk. What is the root value of biceps jerk? Okay, this is homework, okay? Homework for the 8th term is reflexes and their root values for tomorrow. Okay, proceed.
Yes, ma'am. Sensory system examination. Pain intact on both right and left side. Temperature intact both on right and left side. Deep touch intact both sides. Pressure intact both sides. Fine touch. These tests indicate spinothalamic sensation is intact. Then fine touch intact on both sides. Vibration intact. Then joint sensation intact on both sides. This indicates posterior columnar sensation is intact. Then coming to the cortical sensation, tactile localization intact on both sides, 2-point discrimination intact, impression is no sensory defects.
Okay.
Then the local examination is done. So provisional diagnosis.
What did you miss? You finished cranial nerve, you finished motor, you finished sensory, then?
Sensory system.
Then? What else are you supposed to check?
This one, ma'am. Cerebellar function.
Yes. Did you check for them?
Yeah, ma'am. The scanning speech is absent.
What all will you check for in cerebellar? All the examination things you check in cerebellar. From head to toe.
I didn't check that.
Just name the cerebellar signs that you will examine. Anybody else also can answer. Yes, anybody wants to volunteer? Cerebellar sinus, head to toe. Okay, one person said gate, starting from head. Okay, nystagmus is one, yes. What happens to the head movements? What can you see? Yeah, what happens to the head? Titubations, okay? If there is a vomus involvement, you can have to and fro movement of the head like titubations, okay? One thing. Eyes. Eyes, you can have nystagmus, yes. Then coming to the, then in the examination, you can have coordination impairment, which is finger nose test may be positive, finger nose finger test may be positive. Then dystagmatic cocoenesia, that is rapid alternating movement of the hands, that may be impaired, yes. Then intention tremors may be present, that is when you try to grab an object, they may be having intention tremors. The tone may be lower, that is hypotonia may be present. Then lower limb, yes, very good. Rebound phenomenon, yes. Lower limb.
Peduncular niger.
Yes. What is pendular knee jerk. What is pendular knee jerk?
It's the repeating knee jerk.
Not repeating. How will you do pendular? How will you elicit pendular knee jerk? What are your instructions to the patient? When do you say there is a pendular knee jerk? How is he supposed, how is the, what is the patient's position? Yes, patient is supposed to sit at one corner of the bed with his legs freely dangling from the bed and should not be touching the surface of the hand. You elicit the knee jerk, and if you see more than 2.5 oscillations of the leg movement to and fro, then you say it is a pendular knee jerk. Then you are also supposed to check for knee heel shin coordination test in the lower limbs. What happens? Involvement. Somebody said gait. What happens to the gait?
The gait is unstable to stand and walk on his own.
What is the type of gait called?
Swaying.
Ataxic gait, okay? Yeah, they can have an ataxic gait. Yes, cerebellum. What else are you supposed to check?
The examination of skull and spine.
Yes.
It's normal.
Normal. Yes.
Then the stance and gait.
Rhombus, you've checked for somewhere. You've mentioned before, I think.
Yes, ma'am, I didn't get you.
Rhombus, you had mentioned somewhere?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Then, one more thing, gait examination, okay? Don't forget gait examination, especially in this kind of patients. If they're not able to mobilize, then you can say that you are not able to elicit the gait. But otherwise, you're supposed to examine in a CNS case. What kind of gait would you expect in this kind of this patient?
Swinging of the hip and knee.
What is it called? Guidelines. Somebody said white based gate. Where do you see that? Yes. White based is in cerebellar, okay? Alcoholics, where there is, whenever there is a dorsal column involvement, you can have a white based gate. Alcoholics. Okay, this patient can have a hemiplegic gait. What is that? He has weakness of one side of the body, and you said there is increased tone on that side of the body, no, according to your examination. Hypertonia is there, clasp knife spasticity is there. There is increased reflexes on that particular side. So what would you expect? It is a hemiplegic gait. So what do you expect in a hemiplegic?
Ma'am, there is swinging, ma'am, swinging of the hip and knee. Then the pelvis is tilted upwards on the involved.
Swinging, place. No, he'll be having difficulty in lifting that leg. His tone is increased. So he'll be having difficulty raising that tone. He needs some support to lift his leg off the ground because it is very tense from the hip down below. Yes. So he'll be having a circumduction-like movement because he has to lift that leg and keep it back on the ground. So circumduction, and he will have reduced squat steps along with the no shift of weight. He'll be having weighing his balance on one particular side. Okay? Yes.
Yes, ma'am. That completes the local examination.
Okay, fine. Any other system you want to examine in this patient?
CVS examination.
Yes.
It's already mentioned.
Yeah. What would you like to look for in CVS examination? What will your findings be?
Ma'am, there is a hypertension, and the pulse is 170 beats per minute.
Okay.
The S1, S2 sounds are heard normal with no murmur.
You think S1 and S2 will be normal with an irregular pulse rate? With a heart rate of 170, would you be able to appreciate the heart sound?
No, ma'am. No.
If at all you would be able to appreciate, what will happen to the heart sounds? Irregular pulse.
First heart sound will be louder than the.
Okay. If you are saying that, now I have to ask you, when will you see a loud S1?
No idea.
If you have an irregular impulse, it depends on the heart rate. If you have a very high heart rate, you may not be able to hear the heart sounds. And if you have an irregular heart rate, it may be a variable S1. Okay, S1 may be variable. Then, if you have a prolonged hypertension, yes, very good. Somebody said MS. In MS, mitral stenosis, you see loud S1. Okay, now. If you have a hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension, what abnormality in the heart sounds would you like to pick up? What can you have? Which additional heart sound can you have?
Murmurs.
Murmur, no. Which additional heart sound? Heart sound, I said, not adventitious or additional sounds. S4, very good, yes. S4 can be there, okay? Although it is very difficult to pick up on examination, but if it is an uncontrolled hypertension, what is S4? Atria has to contract against a significant resistance distally, so that is why S4 may be, okay? And what else would you like to examine in cardiovascular system?
Ma'am, the general examination is done by the previous person. I did only the local exam.
No, I'm asking cardiovascular system, not general examination. In CVS, what do you want to check? You want to auscultate somewhere and look for something? You are also supposed to check for carotid bruise, okay? Bruise is a nothing but a increased velocity of flow through a narrow vessel. You will be, it is a murmur, but not in the cardiac examination elsewhere. So you're supposed to check for carotid bruise. Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what is your diagnosis, final diagnosis?
Provisional diagnosis is right-sided.
No, provisional diagnosis. This is your final diagnosis.
Right-sided hemiparesis with upper motor neuron involving seventh cranial.
You still want to see upper motor neuron facial paresis? You said forehead furrowing is lost. Process is there. You are an element.
Right-sided hemiplegia.
That is okay. Hemiparesis is fine. Or the cranial nerve palsy. If you have seen forehead furrowing is lost and all of that, it cannot be UMN. It has to be element facial palsy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Yes, proceed. That is the deficit. Anatomical localization. Which arterial territory do you think is involved? What is the anatomical localization?
Middle cerebral artery.
You think it is the middle cerebral artery?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Where would you like to localize it to? Do you want to change the localization? He said it is the internal capsule.
Yes, ma'am. Internal capsule.
Internal capsule cannot have lower motor neuron involvement of facial nerve. Lower motor neuron comes in the brain stem. Okay, after the facial nuclei is there. So it cannot be the internal capsule. If you're saying LMN, if your findings are correct, it cannot be LMN. It has to be LMN. Okay? And if it is LMN, where is the localization? It is in the brainstem, probably before the nucleus. Okay. If it is after the nucleus, then they can develop.
It's not audible.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, now you are audible.
Yeah. Okay. Were you all able to hear the brainstem cross hemiplegia? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am, can you repeat it once more?
Yes. So LMN cannot be, if it is an LMN type of a facial involvement, you cannot localize it to the cortex or the subcortical areas like internal capsule. You will have to localize it further down to the brainstem. Another thing that you have to remember is brainstem has facial nerve nuclei. Now, if it is involved below the facial nerve nuclei, you will have something called as a crossed hemiplegia. Crossed hemiplegia means generally if you see in a UMN lesion, you will have facial nerve affection on the opposite side of the involvement of the cortex, whereas this one, it will be on the same side. The cranial nerve affection along with the motor deficit will be on the same side. Okay, that is the anatomical hospitalization. What is the likely etiology and what is the likely pathology now after examination?
It's likely to be due to thrombotic cause.
You still want to keep it as thrombotic? What was your pulse rate examination finding?
Pulse rate is 170.
Which is irregular. So atrial fibrillation is there. So do you want to change the likely pathology? What were the three types of stroke we said in the beginning of the class?
Thrombotic, embolic and
hemorrhagic. So do you want to change it to something else now?
Embolic maybe.
Probably cardioembolic. Yes. And what is the patient having? Probably atrial fibrillation. Okay, you have to add that in your diagnosis. Probably having atrial fibrillation. The right likely risk factors are diabetes, hypertension, then
smoking,
age of the patient. Okay, these are the likely risk factors. Okay, what would you like to do for this patient? Once he comes to you, what would you like to do? The sixth term or eighth term? Adamya, your sixth term student or eighth term? Okay, fine. What would you like to do for this patient? Once he comes to you, what do you want to do?
Ma'am, investigations.
Yeah.
Management is time dependent.
Okay, management is time dependent. Okay, once a patient with stroke comes to you, okay, and if he presents to you within 4.5 hours of stroke, you are supposed to, it's called as the window period. So suppose it is an ischemic stroke, that is either thrombotic or embolic strokes, you have to calculate something called as an NIHH score, based on which you will decide whether you want to thrombolyze this patient or not, that is to dissolve the thrombus. Okay, so once the patient comes to you and he's presenting within 4.5 hours, you have to do something called as a CT scan, non-contrast CT scan, to see the extent of involvement. You rule out if it is a hemorrhage. Okay, if there is no bleeding, that means he's probably a candidate for thrombolysis based on his NIHH's scoring. Okay, so what you have to give them is something called as a thrombolysis. You have thrombolytic agents, which is RTP, that is alteplase is the commonly used agent, that is recombinant tissue plasminogen activator. At least know the names of these drugs. Okay, we'll go into the detailed discussion once you have further CNS classes. So RTP, other than that, if they are not a candidate for thrombolysis and are not going to thrombolyze, then you're supposed to give them antiplatelets, which is aspirin, clopidogrel, dipyridamole. Okay, these may be given for antiplatelets. If they have dyslipidemia, you're supposed to give them statins, which is atorvastatin, rosuvastatin. Okay, and after that, since this patient has a atrial fibrillation, you're supposed to do a detailed cardiac evaluation as well. You're supposed to get an ECG. You're supposed to get a 2D echo. Look for any source of embolus in the cardiac, whether there is any clot that has dislodged and embolized to any other arterial territory. Okay, cardioembolic strokes, ideally you have to give them anticoagulation, that is enoxaparin, dalteparin, or heparin, unfractionated heparin may be given. Then further you will have to give them physiotherapy. Okay, so these are the main things. Investigations, when you're asked what is the management, you're supposed to say how will you like to investigate and what drugs will you like to give to manage. So investigations, you will have to do a complete blood count. Complete blood count may give you certain information in that he is a smoker. If he's a chronic smoker, he may develop polycythemia, secondary polycythemia, because of chronic smoking and stimulation of erythropoietin. Okay, polycythemia itself is a risk factor for stroke. Okay, because it is a hyperviscous state and it can develop thrombosis. Other than that, you have to, he is a hypertensive and a diabetic both. So you're supposed to get blood sugars. You're supposed to look for renal functions. Okay, and you're supposed to look for lipid profile as well. Is that clear?
Yes.